National Assembly of Wales is now in session, and before we move to the First Minister's questions, it gives me great pleasure to announce, in accordance with Standing Order 26.75, that the Local Government Wales Bill was given royal assent on the 25th of November. So we now move to item one, which is questions to the First Minister, and first this afternoon, Clare Griffith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Will the First Minister make a statement on the impact of the UK Government spending review on the renewable energy sector in Wales? Well, some of it is to be welcomed, namely what they've done regarding district heating and energy efficiency. There is no clarity at present on how this will impact upon Wales, but of course we do still have some concerns about what the UK Government's policy is doing to undermine investor confidence in future renewable energy projects in Wales. Well, I share your concern because the ambition of the UK Government in terms of renewable energy is clearly very different to the ambition that many of us here in Wales would like to see achieved. We know that consents, or the right to consent to major energy projects that are come to Wales, or it will ultimately come to Wales, we hope, and we also know that the national grid is a problem and that the lack of powers over some of the financial incentives is also a problem for us here in Wales. So would you agree with me that the time has come for us not just to settle for having right to consent to major projects, but to ask for some influence too on the financial incentives and the national grid? Well, yes, because I think it's important that we realise, as the member has said, that it's one thing to have power over consenting to renewable energy generation projects, but without any control of the grid itself. And therefore, there is a UK government veto as to how that energy is taken from Wales, and therefore a veto on the project itself. And therefore, my view is that we should be in the same situation as Scotland, namely, we should have control over the grid. And of course, we know that the financial incentives that they've been able to put on the table there have been beneficial to them in terms of attracting projects and jobs into Scotland.
First Minister, I share your concerns as well with regard to last week's CSR. And actually, made no mention of the Tidal Lagoon project in Swansea. And we've since seen that company actually announced redundancies as a consequence of the dithering and actually inept attitude of the UK government. It's an exciting project, offers both clean renewable energy and economic opportunities in South West Wales for jobs and skills. Will you continue to press the UK government to actually a rapid response on the strike price so that we can see that project progress for the Welsh economy to benefit from?
Well, there's an enormous amount of foot dragging taking place in Whitehall. This is a fantastic project, not just in terms of renewable energy, but in terms of the jobs that could be created for the maintenance and manufacturing of the kit that generates that energy. We've heard, of course, of the support that's been given in the past by the UK government, but there is no money on the table, no further decision, and it's about how the people of Wales had a decision from the UK government and were shown that respect.
Janet Howarth.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, the renewable energy sector in Wales contributes significant funding to the Welsh Government through wind turbines being sited on the Welsh woodland estate. Can you confirm the amount of money made by this scheme? And can you provide assurances that this money is retained and spent within the renewable energy sector and environmental projects in Wales?
Well, of course, where there are opportunities for revenue being made available by the Welsh Government, we'll take that, of course, bearing in mind the relevant planning considerations that need to be taken into consideration. What we don't have, however, is any kind of certainty from the UK Government as to what the energy policy that they want actually is. We don't know what their view is on renewables. We know they attacked photovoltaic cells and the subsidies there. They attacked wind turbines, which caused, of course, the closure of Maybe Bridge in Monmouthshire. We know that they've provided substantial funding for the nuclear sector at Hinkley. What we don't know is what else they want to do. And I know, having from my conversations with investors, that this uncertainty is something that is wholly unwelcome to those who wish to invest in energy generation in the UK.
Peter Black.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, as you know, there is a huge amount of concern in the Swansea Bay area about the Tidal Lagoon and about where that project is going to go ahead. I understand fully the Welsh Government's commitment to that scheme and very grateful for your support of it. Can I ask you, what representations are you envisaging being able to make to the UK Government over the next few months to try to tie down their particular view of this lagoon and whether or not they're able to come to a conclusion on this, and how can we assist them in those deliberations?
Well, the message is, get on with it. We'll be making that message clear to them, both orally and in writing. It simply isn't acceptable that one of the major projects in Wales is not being supported as it should be by the UK government. But hey, this is nothing different. We've also seen delays when it comes to electrification, no date given for that, and it shows that there is a tendency towards incredible foot dragging when it comes to job creation in Wales by the UK government, something the Welsh government will never display.
Question two, Darren Miller.
Presiding officer, will the First Minister outline his priorities for the National Health Service in North Wales, please?
Yes, our priorities for the NHS in the North is, as for the rest of Wales, to improve health outcomes, access to services, patient experience, to prevent poor health and to reduce health inequalities.
Thank you for that answer, First Minister. Today is obviously the first day of winter. We know that the Health Board in North Wales is cash strapped. It's forecasting to be £30 million over budget by the end of the current financial year at present, and that's in addition to a carryover of over £20 million from the previous year. What are you doing to make sure that the financial crisis doesn't impact over the winter and that patients can still get access to the services they need? We know, for example, that referrals to Gobowen Hospital at the moment have been halted for people to be able to access some of the orthopaedic services there, all on the basis of finances.
No, local health boards have their winter plans in place. We've been liaising with them for many months, and we expect those plans to be robust. We know that despite the great pressure that was put on the NHS in Wales last winter, that those plans were robust, and we did not see, for example, the situation that took place in England where tents were being used to house patients who needed treatment in A&E.
Alan Fred Jones.
Thank you very much. A review of maternity services is ongoing in North Wales, as you know, one in the short term and one in the long term, and one clear option is to reduce the number of maternity units which are led by medics from 3 to 2. Now, as you have decided that the Cernic is to be placed in Glanclwyd Hospital, it therefore follows that it's a choice between Ysbyty Maelor and Ysbyty Gwynedd. That's what this review will decide upon. Now, is this a sensible approach and a fair process to decide on the structure of maternity care in North Wales for the future when one key decision has been taken out with that context?
Well, what surprises me is that I was under the impression that Plaid Cymru were in favour of the Cernic, because your spokespeople have been saying that we need such a unit in Wales, but now you sound as if you're not in favour of the Cernic. Well, that is a total change to the situation some months ago. But no, we're going to continue with the Cernic. That's what your party members wanted and actually supported. And I believe that a report will be published by the local health board this evening on the plans for the maternity units in their area.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. You mentioned that one of your priorities is to ensure that services are available. I've been in correspondence with the Health Minister for some 2 years now on prosthetics services in Wrexham, and to be fair, the Minister visited the hospital with me some months ago. Now, these services are managed by WISC centrally, but the provision is at a health board level. However, the grades offered to doctors in Wrexham are far lower than those for doctors in the Northwest, and that means that the final prosthetist has said that he is to leave his post. So can I ask you to look into that situation to ensure that the doctor grades are competitive so we can ensure that services remain available in North Wales?
Well, I know that we've spoken to WISC in order to understand the size of the problem, because there has been some problem with recruitment, but we have been told as a government by WISC themselves that they are now addressing these problems. New staff are being recruited, and those staff members will start in the new year, and more recruitment will take place in order to fill any vacant positions while the other recruitment is ongoing.
We now move to questions from the party leaders, and first this afternoon we have the leader of the Welsh Liberal Democrats, Kirsty Williams.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, as world leaders meet in Paris for the Climate Change Conference, we can all agree that governments need to do all they can to tackle the threat of climate change. Now, the Conservative government in Westminster is systematically unravelling any progress that was made on renewables under Liberal Democrat leadership. What representations have you made opposing the UK government's decision to end tax breaks for clean cars, abandon zero carbon housing targets, and scrap support for renewable energy production?
Well, the zero carbon in terms of buildings, of course, is a devolved matter. In terms of scrapping subsidies, is something that we've been very vocal on. We believe this is not the way forward. We are wholly opposed to the direction in which, if there is a direction to which energy generation is going at GB level. It seems clear that energy generation is now being dictated by the Treasury in terms of what is the cheapest form of generating energy in the short term. Energy security is an irrelevant consideration in their minds. We made it very clear that there needs to be a mix of energy generation within the UK. There needs to be greater thought given to energy security. And the trend towards scrapping subsidies for renewables has to be reversed.
Thank you for that answer, First Minister. But let's examine your government's record in this area. Now, Wales lags behind the rest of the UK in reducing greenhouse gas emissions. Why have Scotland and England managed to reduce emissions by about a third, whilst in Wales we've managed just a decrease of 12%?
Well, for part of the reason is that we have a higher proportion of energy-intensive industries. As they have strengthened, so their emissions have gone up, that much is true, even though they have invested in reducing emissions. But secondly, of course, we don't have the powers that Scotland and England have got. Scotland has the powers that it needs over energy generation. It has the powers over grid connections. It has the powers to incentivise renewable energy in a way that we have not. And coming back to the point that was made by the member, Clare Hughes-Griffith, we need to see a level playing field between Wales on the one hand and Scotland and England on the other.
First Minister, that old chestnut again. The last time I asked you these questions, you gave the same answer. Germany has a huge amount of energy intensive industry, much, much larger than ours, and yet their record on cutting greenhouse emissions is commendable. Now, Labour leaders are full of warm words about these issues. Now, recently, 50 Labour councils in England pledged to reduce by 100% by 2050 their emissions. And your shadow energy secretary stated that where Labour was in power, we will push for a clean energy boom. Why then has your government refused to lead with ambition by supporting a target of a 100% reduction in greenhouse gas emissions by 2050 in legislation before this House?
Well, energy-intensive industries are going through a difficult time, especially with the cost of energy in the UK, and we must balance, of course, any decision without prejudice in terms of the target against the effect that it might have on those energy-intensive industries. That's the thinking, that's the debate that's taking place at the moment. But in terms of looking to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, it's something that we strongly support, and I'm glad to hear that I gave the same answer to her in answer to the same question some months ago. It shows at least that we are showing consistency in terms of the answers that we give, and we need to see a level playing field in terms of powers as between Wales, Scotland and England.
And we now move to the Leader of the Opposition, Andrew Archie-Davies.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, obviously in all the news programmes and bulletins at the moment is the terrible scenes of destruction out in the Middle East, and in particular the vote that will take place later this week on whether military action should be undertaken in Syria by British Armed Services. You have given numerous interviews as recently as 10 days ago saying that you supported military action in Syria. There shouldn't be a border or recognise the border between Iraq and Syria. Is that you personally speaking, or are you speaking on behalf of the Welsh Government?
That's my view, as speaking personally, and it's a view that will be different to some in my party, but nevertheless, it's my view.
Interestingly, all the articles obviously quote you as First Minister, and so people do take that as being the government view. They do. It is important that people do. It is important that people do obviously examine their constituency postbags and also the position that Britain finds itself in with a plea from the French government to support their actions in addressing the atrocities in Paris some 2 weeks ago. What action will you be taking? Because you do have a substantial role within the Labour Party. You are the most senior elected figure within the Labour Party. What will you be doing as First Minister of Wales to convey your own view, but also I would suggest the majority view, that we stand shoulder to shoulder with our allies in France and address the terrible scenes we're seeing in Syria?
Well, it's the job of the Prime Minister to provide the evidence in order for that, for MPs to examine that evidence and decide which they want to vote. It's not my job to do that. I've expressed my view on this. I take the view that there needs to be a final plan. I don't see that at the moment. I take the view there needs to be thought given to which ground forces are going to be supported. I don't see progress on that at the moment. I do take the view that there's no difference in reality between Iraq and Syria. The borders effectively disappeared. But what troubles me is that we should, or what concerns me is that we should not do what happened in Iraq more than a decade ago, and that is to take military action without thinking about what the end game is and how to bring peace to Syria. And I do not see sufficient evidence of that yet on the part of the Prime Minister.
I disagree with you, not the evidence from the Prime Minister, but I agree entirely with you. We do need the end game in stabilising Syria because of all the situation that is developing out in that country and the immigration crisis and people being forced from their homes. But ultimately, the horrendous acts by ISIL in that country against every man, woman and child that they seem to come in contact with. It is a fact that in Wales, 27,500 service men and women have families here and obviously reside here. There is a big defence estate here in Wales that relies on orders from the armed services. I do believe that it is important that the First Minister of Wales, and you've done that via interviews that you've given, offering your support, but it does need to be clarified that that is personal support, not government support. But you do have a role, do you not, First Minister? You do have a role in making sure that we speak with one voice and ultimately support our armed services when they are committed to ground offences or air offensive in Syria. Do you not, as First Minister, have a key role to play in doing that?
Well, the Leader of the Opposition is now saying that he is in favour of British ground forces being used in Syria.
Anywhere in the world.
That's what he's just said.
Anywhere in the world.
And I do find that worrying, because that's certainly not my view. It's certainly not the view of the Prime Minister either, but that is exactly what he has just said. The view that I take is that I would not want to see British forces being in a position where politicians had not given sufficient thought to what those forces were there to do. And it means ensuring, first of all, that we understand which sides are being supported in Syria, which ground forces. The Prime Minister has not made that clear. Are we looking at the Peshmerga and the Free Syrian Army? Are we looking at any others? Because there are forces more moderate than ISIL in Syria, but they're not people who we would regard as moderate in terms of the people who support them. He's right to point out that Daesh, I mean, call them what we want, the Islamic State, need to be eradicated, but airstrikes will not do that on their own. They will target, that's true, some in that organisation, but civilians will also get hurt. Now, it's important to understand that airstrikes are a part of what needs to be a far bigger and broader plan. They are not sufficient on their own. The only way in which you remove ground forces is to support ground forces, perhaps through airstrikes, but ultimately thinking about what happens at the end. The reason why Syria has been destabilized is because there's not been a coherent and consistent international view as to which side or sides should be supported in the ground war. Until that's clear, it's very difficult to see what airstrikes would achieve beyond creating a situation where Daesh remains on the ground, but we see more and more civilian casualties. If there's evidence to suggest that it would support ground forces in their objective of ridding that part of the world from Daesh, if there's evidence to suggest that it would shorten the conflict, if there's evidence to suggest that it would lead to a plan for peace in Syria, then if that evidence is strong enough, as I have said, I would personally support airstrikes. But that evidence is not yet there, and my concern is that too much emphasis is being given to airstrikes and not enough to what needs to be done in order to bring peace to Syria.
And finally, the Leader of Plaid Cymru, Leanne Wood.
Diolch, Llywydd. First Minister, you've gone on record with your views on the situation in Syria, and I think it's entirely appropriate that you've done that, especially as Wales will be affected in terms of troops, in terms of the involvement of Welsh services in terms of dealing with the refugee crisis, and also the security risk to Welsh communities. Now, you've gone on record as saying that you would only consider supporting UK airstrikes in Syria if there was a plan in place for peace and stability. Do you agree with me now then that the Prime Minister's statement last week on proposals for UK airstrikes falls short of those tests?
As I've said over the last few days, I don't believe that there is sufficient evidence there yet to support airstrikes.
Thank you for your answer, First Minister. As of the 27th of November, you said that you'd not been privy to any discussion at UK level within your party on the proposals for UK airstrikes on Syria. Have you been involved in any discussions since, and have you had any discussions with the Labour Party in Wales on this matter?
No, there's a free vote on this issue at Westminster. It's for each Member of Parliament to make up his or her own mind as to how they wish to vote.
Okay, well, thank you for your answer, First Minister. Now, in your public remarks, you've said that we must learn the lessons from the Iraq War, and I would agree with you on that point. At the time, back in 2003, your predecessor said that he did not have a view on that war, and I welcome the fact that you, at least, have gone on record as the UK considers yet again intervening in the Middle East. On this occasion, then, will the Welsh Government join other parties and other devolved administrations, if possible, in opposing the proposed bombing of Syria? And will you appeal directly to the Prime Minister to reconsider his government's plans to bomb that country?
Well, first of all, it wasn't my understanding that her party, nor indeed the SNP, who made the announcement some days beforehand, were actually against airstrikes in principle, namely that the evidence would be considered. It's clear from her views, and I understand that she doesn't feel that the evidence is strong enough to justify those airstrikes, and that's a position that I also share. But nevertheless, I do take the view that as the UK Parliament considers this issue, that it considers the issue of how to bring peace to Syria in the broadest possible sense. Airstrikes, it could be argued, can suppress the capacity for terrorist attacks. They cannot remove the capacity for terrorist attacks. That can only be done by removing the threat on the ground. And I have to say, at this moment in time, I don't believe that there is sufficient evidence before Parliament, or indeed the people of Wales, and the people of the UK, to suggest that airstrikes on their own would act in a way to shorten the war and remove the threat of Daesh. Nor do I believe that there is sufficient information that would allow us to conclude that that support is being given to a substantial ground force. The Prime Minister talked of 70,000. It's not clear where those 70,000 ground forces are or which organisations they represent. So at this moment in time, I have to say, I don't think the evidence is there to justify airstrikes. That evidence may strengthen in the days and weeks to come, but at this moment in time, it's not there.
We now move back to questions on the paper, and question three is Lynn Eagle.
First Minister make a statement on the potential impact of the UK government spending review on local government in Wales?
Yes, we are considering the implications of that announcement. Further details will be provided on the 9th of December with the publication of the provisional local government settlement.
First Minister, last week's spending review delivered little more than smoke and mirrors for working families, another revenue funding cut for Wales, and signalled the decimation of local government in England. This Welsh Labour government has always worked hard to protect local government, and in particular social services, recognising as we do that the health service and social services are inextricably linked and that you can't protect one without looking after the other. What assurances can you give today that despite the savage cuts over the border, the protecting local government and in particular social services will continue to be a priority for this Welsh Labour government?
We will look to protect local government and the services that local government provides to the best of our financial ability. But I don't know whether talking about local government in England is actually a proper description anymore. I'm not sure local government will exist in England in the next few years. With the substantial cuts that are occurring in local government there, it's difficult to see what councils will actually do. We know that council tax will increase substantially in England over the next few years to pay for social care. What's pernicious about what the Chancellor has suggested is this. He is abdicating the responsibility of UK government to pay for social services in England. And secondly, he is saying that councils have to raise their own money if they want to provide social services in their own areas. That means that the poorer areas that don't have a substantial council tax base will not be able to provide the services to a population that probably will need those services more. And you begin to ask yourself if there is no mechanism, if the mechanism for or redistributing money around the UK from the richest to the poorest areas is being eroded, where does that leave the concept of the UK?
Jonathan Saunders.
Meanwhile, back to Wales. First Minister, given the increase in cash terms in funding coming to Wales over the next 4 years and the calls yesterday from the leader of Denbighshire County Council for you to apply the same principles to local government, what guarantees are you now able to make in terms of a fair settlement for local government budgets here in Wales?
Well, I can assure the Leader of Denbighshire we won't be applying the principles of the UK government when it comes to English local government. I can give him that assurance without any shadow of a doubt. And secondly, the member is not correct in her assumption. This is a 4.5% cut in our budget in Wales. Not some kind of great increase in the budget. I mean, only a Tory could interpret a 4.5% cut as a good thing. Or an increase,
funding.
But there it is. Now, we will look at the financial settlement, and the statement will be made on the 9th of December, but we will not be looking to slash local government funding as in England, and we will not be looking to transfer the burden of paying for social care on local government in Wales as is being done in England.
First, Minister, I wouldn't disagree with what you say about the impact of the Westminster cuts on the Welsh Government budget, but I would wish to hear what exactly your vision will be for local government in Wales. Do you view local government as something that will contract over the next decade with the services to the people being reduced, or do you have a broader vision about local government in Wales?
With the right structure and more devolution of powers to local authorities, not only to the counties but also to town councils and community councils too. So no, I see that devolution happening with the right structure in place over the next few years.
Eleanor Parrott.
Geoff Lowith, I was glad to hear your answer, First Minister, that you want to see devolution of more powers to local authorities. And one of the powers we've discussed previously is to give them more control over business rates and enable them to incentivise economic development and grow additional revenues given the very difficult circumstances. When will the Welsh Government then take steps towards this devolution of business rates and enabling local authorities to do this?
Well, 2 points. As I've said before, the structure needs to be right first. I don't believe that it is. Secondly, I would be very wary of devolving business rates wholly to local government. I see the member nodding. The reason being, of course, that we estimate 17 local authorities out of 22 would end up with less money. So Monmouthshire, for example, would be £4.3 million down if business rates were raised and wholly retained within Monmouthshire. So there has to be a mechanism in place to redistribute money rather than saying to local authorities, you raise and you keep.
McAntony.
First Minister, the most disgraceful part of the Tory spending review is the failure to make any financial provision whatsoever to support adult social care. In Wales, the Conservatives are arguing for a ring fencing of health spending, but at the expense of social care. Yeah. Do you believe that the Tories in Wales, is it your view, they have now abandoned adult social care in Wales and thrown our vulnerable adults to the wolves?
Look, we've long learned that when it comes to policy, pretty much when we see the Conservatives in Wales, it's for Wales, see England. They basically copy what happens in England. And we see in England adult social care being absolutely destroyed. Despite that, of course, we spend more on health per head in Wales than England does. We spend far more on health and social care in Wales than the government in England, in the UK does in England. So we know that we spend more on education, on health, and on health and social care combined. That's what happens when you get a Labour government rather than the cutting instincts of the Tories.
Question 4, Kirsty Williams.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Will the First Minister make a statement on the availability of bus services in Brecon and Radnorshire?
Well, we recognise the importance of effective and affordable bus services and our commitment to improving the quality and accessibility of local bus services and community transport is laid out in the National Transport Finance Plan, which was published in July.
First Minister, your plan seems to be greatly at odds with the decision by Powys County Council at the beginning of November to cut substantially bus services. It means there is no longer a town service in Bilth Wells, leaving many elderly people isolated in their own home, unable to get into town for their shopping. And if you live in Trecastle now, there is no public transport whatsoever through that village. You can't get into Brecon and you can't travel to Llandovery for services or for work purposes. What can your government do to ensure communities like Bilth Wells and Trecastle are not abandoned in terms of public transport? And what flexibility can you give to new ways of delivering publicly funded transport services in their community if large buses are no longer viable?
Yes, with three things. First of all, that decision, of course, is for Powys to explain, because it's not a Welsh Government decision. But secondly, there are alternative modes of provision. The Booker bus service has been widely used in Carmarthenshire and elsewhere now for some time in communities with a similar population density. I don't know the extent of, or indeed whether such a service exists in Powys, but that is something that the council needs to look at, it would seem to me, because others have done it successfully, and that's worked in very rural communities. And of course, in the medium term, powers over bus regulation will rest here, and that will make it easier in terms of being able to direct where bus services should run in the future.
William Graham.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. First Minister, the Community Transport Association have highlighted the need for stable, long-term funding for the community transport sector. Then in particular, the impact of the reduction in the minimum ring-fenced funding by your government's reduction of the bus service support grant by 50%. Would you commit to looking again at this grant and perhaps devising an adequate strategy which would give much closer examination for bus services to all parts of rural Wales?
Well, it does surprise me when I stand here week after week and hear every Tory ask for more money in every area, ignoring the fact, and he is not a culprit normally, I'd say that to him, but I mean, but I hear it, we hear it every year week, don't we? More money here, more money there, as if the cuts haven't actually happened. I believe it is exceptionally important for local authorities to look at the most cost-effective way of providing transport to their areas, and indeed, Carmarthenshire have done that with Booker Bus, and I know, for example, that the grassroots project in Munnershire has been very successful in terms of delivering transport opportunities for rural communities.
Question five, Russell George.
Will the First Minister make a statement on how the Welsh Government intends to incentivise GPs to practice in Mid Wales?
Well, the actions that need to be taken to support GPs are set out in our plan for the primary care workforce. Those actions include work to incentivise general practice, both in terms of entry into training and taking up practice in areas where there are shortages of doctors.
Thank you for your answer, First Minister. There are currently five surgeries in Montgomeryshire which are attempting to recruit GPs. And over the past 3 years, the medical practice in Newtown, for example, has spent thousands of pounds in recruitment, trying to recruit, and not one suitable candidate has come forward. A very similar position also in Llanidloes. There is a concern that surgeries are having to change their practices in a way that doesn't allow patients direct contact with GPs. Now, in addition to the efforts of Powys Teaching Health Board, will you commit the Welsh Government to promoting local GP vacancies on its website? I'd be grateful for your views on your wider views on what other measures can be taken to incentivise GPs specifically to Mid Wales.
First of all, of course, the Mid Wales Health Collaborative is working well. It had its first meeting on the 23rd of November, I understand, and that's being supported in terms of the work that is taking forward. I know that the Health Board is working with the practices in Machynlleth and in Newtown. A number of solutions are being implemented to support those practices, including workload support through the deployment of pharmacists, advanced nurse practitioners, physiotherapists, and clinical triage as well by advanced nurse practitioners. And I know that the Health Board has been working with the CHC and the local medical committee to ensure that applications through the GP sustainability assessment framework are assessed and addressed rapidly. So good work is being done ensure the sustainability of practices in Powys and indeed elsewhere. And they are also looking at different models for delivering primary care services. For example, allowing GP practices to deliver different services, social enterprises. There are a number of ways in which they are looking to vary the service as far as attracting GPs is concerned, but also, of course, to improve the service for patients.
Question six, Ellen Jones.
What discussions has the First Minister had with the UK government on the future of S4C?
Well, I recently wrote to the Secretary of State for Culture, Media and Sport calling for an urgent review of S4C, which of course had been promised by the United Kingdom government. And I've also written to him asking for an urgent meeting to discuss S4C and other broadcasting issues.
Thank you, First Minister. And last week, you'll know that George Osborne cut 26% of the DCMS budget for S4C, whilst the Secretary of State, John Whittingdale, who was responsible for that, was boasting that he had managed to retain the budget for the arts in England without any cut, but treated S4C in an entirely different way. Now, you're the minister with responsibility for the Welsh language, and I think it's true to say that the future of Welsh language broadcasting is in the balance at present, and therefore I welcome the fact that you have written asking for a meeting with John Whittingdale. I think it is crucially important now that that Secretary of State accepts that request for a meeting and that takes place in order to overturn this decision and to provide a safe funding basis for S4C in the future. That's what the Conservatives pledged in their manifesto prior to the election. It's important that they keep to their promise and for you to hold that important meeting.
Well, as regards the noise that I heard from the Tory benches, they were denying that such a pledge was made, but they did hear that pledge being made. What's clear is that we should have a sustainable settlement for the funding of S4C, which isn't the case at the moment, and that we see the pledge on S4C being kept. So we now await the response of the Secretary of State on whether we can have a meeting to secure the future of S4C.
Thank you very much, and thank you to the First Minister for his words too. Now, despite the excellent statement made on the CSR, we share members' disappointment on the proposals for a direct disproportionate cut to the budget of S4C, and I can assure you that the Welsh Conservatives will be submitting comments to the UK government to make the case for not implementing those proposals. Do you agree that a united voice on this issue is likely to have the greatest effect and that the objective is more important than making localised political points?
Well, I see that Gito Bebb's influence is very strong amongst the Conservatives and what he's been tweeting on this issue. I welcome the fact that there is strong criticism from the Welsh Conservatives about what's happening to S4C, and I'm sure that they would be very supportive to ensure that a meeting takes place with the Secretary of State in order to secure the future of Welsh language broadcasting.
First Minister, what message does the Welsh Government intend to take to the UN Climate Change Summit in Paris?
Well, we want to see an ambitious, legally binding global climate agreement underpinned by transparency and accountability, which will deliver against the scientific imperative.
First Minister, you are probably aware that the UN Global Compact survey of world leaders indicates that a majority are very positive about the growth and innovation that can come from addressing the climate challenge, and that increases to 70% amongst the top leaders in the world's biggest companies. And here in Wales, the groundbreaking work we've been doing at the Low Carbon Research Institute, the development of the house as a power station, and last week's launch of the Compound Semiconductor Centre for Europe, which is all about developing sustainable technologies and more efficient energy generation. Can we not be bold and promise some really clear targets for the Welsh Government that we could take to Paris, some interim targets up to 2020 for the fifth Assembly Government, as well as that 100% by 2050?
Well, I think the important thing is that there is an international agreement. Whilst we, of course, can make our contribution in Wales, we are very small compared to the world's major emitters. What is encouraging is that in the run-up to COP21, we've seen a groundswell of momentum coming from businesses declaring their commitment to decarbonisation, and that's been the major difference between Paris and Copenhagen, where that wasn't really happening in the same way. It's one of the reasons why the UN now described the transition to low carbon as inevitable and irreversible. As a government, of course, we are committed to green growth and to maximising the benefits of the transition to low carbon for Wales. And that was the approach that I outlined in Energy Wales, a low carbon transition. And of course, we continue to look to deliver that.
Russell George.
First Minister, you have previously said it will be a challenge to achieve your own government's targets to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. The Welsh Government has cut its climate change budget by 6%. I know the UK government's made a commitment to increase funding. Would you not agree that if the Welsh Government is to meet its target, then sufficient budgetary commitments do have to be attached to that target?
More money again. So how much money is going to be bid for during the course of the afternoon? DEFRA's budget has been hammered, if the member hasn't noticed, in England, to the point that we are concerned about the services that DEFRA might DEFRA deliver in Wales. I do not see any commitment by the UK government to promote renewable energy. I do not see any commitment by the UK government to move to a low carbon economy. Otherwise, why would they have cut subsidies to photovoltaic? Why would they have cut subsidies to wind? Why are they looking primarily to have more gas-fired power stations, importing the gas as they go? No, we need to make sure that we create more renewable energy, that we reduce our greenhouse gas emissions, and of course, we have more energy security than the Tories are prepared to allow us.
Shane Griffith.
Diolch Llywydd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Now, not one of the nations that's failed to reach its targets under the Kyoto Protocol has faced any sort of sanctions, which in my view has meant that many nations have got away with not meeting their commitments. Now, you as a government have a representative out there in Paris. Will that representative be making a case for the introduction of sanctions over those countries that can't meet their targets under the current Paris negotiations?
Well, that's fine in principle, but practically that's very difficult, of course, because you have to have the agreement of those countries in order to secure a global agreement. And at present, what's important is that an agreement exists in the same tradition as the Kyoto Protocol. And of course, once that is reached, to consider how that agreement should be policed. It's true to say, of course, that you have to have an agreement that people can adhere to. So securing the agreement is the first step. Then the second step is to ensure that there is a means of at least naming those countries that have broken the agreement.
Question 8, Janet Finch-Saunders.
Yeah. Will the First Minister make a statement on the Welsh Government's budgetary priorities for health and social care?
Yes, we've invested more in the Welsh Health Service than ever before. In the last 2 years, we've invested an extra £1 billion in the Welsh NHS, despite the £1.3 billion which has been cut from the overall Welsh budget by the UK government since 2011. And we are not looking to local government to fund social care.
Thank you, First Minister. I'm sure you will join me in welcoming the historic funding floor introduced by the UK Conservative government, set at 115% in line with the Holtham Commission's recommendation. A level that you yourself have previously called for, and the increase of £945 million to Wales's consequential share of increased health spending in England. Will you now commit to protecting the health budget in Wales in real terms?
Well, first of all, the floor is fine in principle, but because there's no commitment beyond 2020, it doesn't work. And so we need to see a commitment to a floor beyond 2020, otherwise the floor is not going to be effective. If that floor is to stay in place, it needs to stay in place for a substantial amount of time, not for 5 years. That simply isn't going to be enough. In terms of the consequential, we're not getting a consequential over £900 million. Well, I don't know where she gets that figure from. I can say the consequential from the CSR is £110 million for this year. And so the suggestion that somehow we are getting consequentials for health alone is quite simply untrue. Because as the party opposite full well knows, where we get consequentials, we get negative consequentials in other areas. And so what the Chancellor gives with one hand, he takes away with the other. And so the consequential for the coming financial year is £110 million. It's not more than that.
Mick Antoniff.
As ministers, the Tories preside over the destruction of adult social care. Do you agree with me that we must do all we can to maintain a comprehensive adult social care system in Wales. But do you share my genuine concern that Offa's Dyke could become the dividing line between the failure and destruction of adult social care services in England whilst the maintenance of a comprehensive package of adult social care in Wales?
Yeah. I believe that, that if we look at the way things are going in England, that in time our border will become the difference between care on one side and neglect on the other.
Lindsay Whittle.
First Minister, can you explain why the Public Health Bill makes no reference to child obesity at all?
Well, these are matters, of course, that can be examined as the bill progresses through the Assembly. I'm sure if members have ideas as to how the bill might be improved, the Minister, I'm sure, would look to consider how that can be done.
David Rees.
First Minister, you recently commented upon the recent figures that indicate that the spend in Wales per person on health and social care is actually greater than in England. Mm-hmm. And as the Member for Pontypridd and the Member for Torfaen have actually identified, the Welsh Labour Government actually believe that health and social care are inextricably linked together, and as such, we fund it properly. Do you believe that with the actually increased delayed transfer of care in English hospitals and the blocking they create, it's time the Welsh model was actually used in England?
Do you know what you find with the Tories? The more uncomfortable they get, the more they shout. And the less they understand, the more they laugh. That's one of the things that they find. Yeah, Darren Millar's right. Record-breaking cuts in social care in England. Record-breaking cuts in social care in England. People who will be neglected. People who will not get the care that they need. And the responsibility being dumped on local authorities and his Chancellor and his party abdicating their responsibility for older people. Insufficient funding for the NHS in England. We saw that from their own figures. Insufficient funding for education in England. We saw that from their own figures. And now we see older people who will be denied social care in the future because of an appalling attitude by the UK government that will lead to the most record-breaking cuts for older people any part of the UK has ever seen.
Thank you, First Minister.